Thank you, everyone, for coming in. Thank you so much for coming in this evening. First things first, it's a small room. If you could take your version of this and please just click it so that it doesn't interrupt us for the next hour, very much appreciated. Thank you. But for the next hour, we could just do the lecture. Now, it's a great pleasure to welcome Wolf Prix back in the building, back here at the AA, where a longtime friend, supporter, student, teacher, and many other forms of visitor here at the school. And in fact, it's an annual project of mine to invite Wolf to the AA. And I've been doing that for several years, and I'm pleased that this year, in addition to saying yes, I'll come, he's actually here with us in the room. It's usually a project to get Wolf in any particular room during any given year, owing to his incredibly busy calendar and diary, and it's just great, Wolf, that we could have you in 2012, at the end of this year, the beginning of 2013, which I realized this morning will mark almost exactly the 40th anniversary of Wolf's first visit here to the school, where he and a group of teachers and students and collaborators and band members, in fact, began a remarkable career in different ways with a project that he undertook with AA students just up the road. In fact, on the rooftop of an abandoned house not very far from here, at a time in which, and I think most students can't imagine this, most of London was occupied by abandoned buildings of the 18th and 19th century. Wolf and his collaborators, which included a few teachers, well-known teachers here at the AA, attached a silver balloon to the top of that house with the ambition that it would take that house up into the sky. And I think it's fair to say that Wolf and his partners and many, many collaborators in the office and at the various schools he's taught in over the years have been trying to airlift architecture ever since. And it's wonderful that we can get a chance to see his most recent examples of that work this evening. I had a chance to meet Wolf for the first time 25 or so years ago as a fifth year student here at the AA when we were taken by our unit master to go visit a small studio in Vienna. And to see two very small, almost minuscule projects, one of which was about 50 square meters, an incredible ground floor studio that he and his partners had built for an artist in Vienna. Short version of the story is that we as AA students arrived in Vienna looking for the office. It was an incredibly rainy, snowy December morning, and knocked on the door tentatively, went upstairs, had a door slightly cracked open, which was claimed to be the offices of Coop Himmelb. The lights were turned off, but we heard sounds inside, went inside. Wolf and his partners were working in the dark that morning in Vienna. Made absolutely no sense to any of us that were visiting from the outside, but in fact was part of an experiment that Wolf and his collaborators have almost instinctively pursued from that point forward. And I think for young architects at that point in their career, you will never get a better example of what it means to work in the dark, fumbling forward to form the kind of remarkable push that Himmelb has done in so many ways for architecture more generally. In the 1970s, it was a practice that came together around things like inflatable bubbles, foam performance pieces, a burning installation, and many other things, performances, materials that one wouldn't normally think of as architecture. It very quickly matured into tour de force demonstrations with steel, glass, and other materials. By the late 1980s, Wolf was installing right out here on the square follies, I think they were called at the time, that were actually the first large-scale prototypes Himmelb pursued. Testing ideas that had existed largely in graphic form or in performance mode to that point in their career. I think it was exactly the kind of project that inspired us a few years ago to bring back pavilions and other large-scale undertakings as a way of teaching and working at a school like this. And I think all any of us would try and do today is to live up to what Wolf and his generation set as the kind of standard for what it means to be brave and to experiment without full understanding of where work might be going, but with a belief that it must be done in complete conviction. Over the last 25 years, Wolf has been a teacher and a professor of architecture at many schools, including this one and SciArc, or the Southern California Institute for Architecture in Los Angeles. He was a faculty member in the 1990s at Columbia University, has taught at Harvard University, and in fact teaching has been an incredibly important extension to his work as an architect. For 20 years, he shaped what is undoubtedly one of Europe's leading academies of architecture, the Angewandte, or the University of Applied Arts, in Vienna, where he retired in 2012, stepping down as vice chancellor of the institute and as a professor of architecture there. He is the recipient of many awards related to both the work of his studio and his teaching, including this country's award for the Annie Spink Award for Architectural Education, and in 2008, the Jencks Award that recognizes the work of both theoretical and practical understanding of architecture. To this day is the CEO, founder, and director of a remarkable office, Coop Himmelb. Join me in welcoming Wolf Pricks back to the air.
Thank you very much. The longer I listen to you, Brad, the older I get. Yeah? I have
younger,
to say,
yeah. Younger.
Yeah, so 40 years ago, 50 years ago, so.
The new middle age.
Thank you very much for inviting me. I did it.
I'm really delighted that
Charles is here. A very old colleague, and we had a long dispute about architecture a long time ago. Now we are common sense, yeah? We have common ground, actually. And I'm really delighted that my young colleague, Para Patrick, is here. I'm his agent, yeah? You know, Para Patrick Sisson, you have to know. Actually, it's better for me. I prefer to have him on stage. I'm sitting in the audience because he can talk. I just heard a really great lecture of him on SIAC. It took 2 hours, but usually I leave after 1 hour. Yeah, but he nailed me on the chair. Yeah, it was very interesting and provoking a kind of discourse in my brain. Anyway, so thank you for joining me here. I know a story about architects later on, maybe. So the title of the lecture is "Don't Worry, in Only 2 Days, Tomorrow Will Be Yesterday." I think it's a precise definition of time. And this is, I said that, so to say, and Newton said, space is an empty stage where we can watch the drama of the universe. So we defined right now time and space, and this is the lecture, actually. I could leave, basically. So Himmelblau, yeah? Everyone is asking me, what means this parenthesis where the L is in between? I only can explain that in German. The parenthesis turns blue, the paradigm blue, into paradigm building. I only can do that in German because in English it would like sound like blue and boo. It makes sense if we criticize a bad architectural piece, boo. Maybe we can introduce that to some critics. The lecture has 2 parts. In the first part, I show all my projects. In the second one, maybe we have time to discuss where these projects are coming from and where they could lead. Since we made about, in this last 40 years, about 600 projects, I have to make a shortcut through this project. And it's called 40 Years in 4 Minutes. Thank you. music is from the 50 years old Rolling Stones, and it's called Give Me Shelter. That means it's a little bit an architectural piece, yeah? Give Me Shelter. Could be that they are outdated with this remark, but the music is still great, yeah? And Keith is actually the best guitar player I know because he is an inventor. You know, that he really, this is another story. He plays an open guitar, he gets rid of the sixth string, therefore the sound of the Rolling Stones is very special. Anyway, when we started 42 years ago, something like that, there were two architects, I would say. No, they are not architects. Two guys which were our role model. Not because of the personality, but because what they said. And it's still very important for us. Che Guevara said this, let's be realistic, let us do the impossible. And Bob Dylan said something very important for students. Don't follow leaders, watch the parking meters. And you don't need a weatherman to know which way the wind blows. This is a remark about sustainability, I would say. This leads me to a kind of statement about society. When we started our career, we wanted to do projects for an open society, not for an authoritarian, closed society. And we really figured out that our open society and our complex society is coming from the very important movement in Europe, the Enlightenment. And the Enlightenment had two sentences or two topics developed, which are still very important. The first thing is the self-determination, which is related to Bob Dylan's saying, and open systems. So how can we describe an open society or a complex society? I think the best would be in comparison. I would like to compare a Stone Age hunter with a contemporary guy. The Stone Age hunter, of course, is able to follow the track of a deer on a stony ground. He is really a specialist. But compared to a guy who finds at the right time, the right in an airport, the right gate, finding the right plane which brings him to the right place, it's much more complex. And our brain is more, I would say, more open developed in this direction. So, there is a sentence which is still very important for us. Everybody is right, but nothing, really nothing is correct. So the question is compared and introduced in all these spheres, what is architecture? And my answer is yes. So what's the difference? Number three, you know this painting. If not, you should study car seller or something like that. So you know that. Now it looks like that. Or the other way around, it looks like that. So so what's the difference, actually? Both have very important fingers. So what's the difference, number four? You know, I heard that in the United States, this is the goal of the future architecture. Little, small, sustainable houses, yeah? Built out of wood. Please, this is the future. Little boxes.
Little box.
So, compared to this very generous, really, really good to live in space, how can we gain that again? I have a proposal. We should extend the meter by 5 centimeters. So this is the new meter. That will bring us a 15% increased volume. That means that 15% more budget can be evaluated or diminished if we think about inflation 5% that we built this building 3 years earlier. Tell that your client. More serious things about private and public space, which is actually was always in the forefront of our work, to combine both or design a new kind of public space. Beijing, Mexico City, Beijing again, private and public in Toronto. Yeah, it's funny, yeah, look at this, tanks, military, and police guys. Is this the new public space? Yeah, and I think this is a very important issue. Tahrir place where the Arabic Revolution started. But this is a place, it's located, it has an address. Occupy movement, they have an address where they can congregate. This is very important because nowadays I heard many times young architects saying that we don't need cities anymore, we have the handy, the mobile phone, and we can networking all over the world. Correct. Yeah, true, but not correct. We need actually an address. Because if we think the virtual place to the very end, the moving airplanes are also a public space, but if you think that way, so what I think is that we have to develop new strategies for a new kind of public space, which looks very, very different, of course, because we have different methods to define it. Not only in an architectural way, but also in a political way. So what we are doing right now, we're doing a big research about a role model of our of the new city plan is our brain, a dynamic network which actually changes according to the problem which it has to solve. I think this is a very important issue in the future of our cities. This is the first step, is kind of basic point of departure, where we replaced the building lines. It's a proposal where we replaced the building line by energy lines. But if we talk to city planners in our cities like that, we are like all the architects, the theoretical architects, which are sitting in an ivory tower and speaking like this to their clients. They listen, seemingly interested, but they don't hear, and they don't understand. And the critics writing architectural critics like that, this is a poem of a German poet, Morgenstern, he calls it the night song of the fishes. So we have to develop new presentation modes, I think. And it's very important to look to presentations which are exceptional. And I found one. I found Christopher Warden as an architect waiting for his client to present him the model. Beautiful office. You could say he's a little bit tensed. Break, 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 break
This is the moment.
So the client is going to get you through the door. Now the actor shows up. Imagine seeing Philip Johnson dancing like that. And we have to know that, and this is a global problem that mediocrity knows no respect. So therefore we have to, like a cat, develop seven lives. And the first life, enough is not enough. And we want more. The architects always have to want more. And I'm very proud to introduce you one of my texts, Architecture Must Place, read by Che Guevara.
Es un símbolo para todos los pueblos oprimidos. Playa Girón es la primera derrota del imperialismo en América Latina, pero también es una de las primeras derrotas del imperialismo en escala mundial.
Spanish-speaking people came to me and said, this is a wrong translation. This was actually a performance action in 1980.
Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm a man of will and taste.
John Lennon was shot exactly the same day. And architecture is not surface, it's content. We should know that. Otherwise, it looks like that. Do you know a song from Lady Gaga? Can you sing it? No, she's famous not because of music, she's famous because of surface. So watch out. If architecture looked like this, maybe it's a little bit like slick shapes, but the content is plastic, Botox. We call that decaf architecture or Botox architecture. Architecture, therefore, I think is a synergy between content and form. I know that I cannot translate Gestalt into the English language. Yeah? Gestalt is more than just form. I would say, and this is my kind of approach and my, let's say, theory, if there is a theory, that if there is a synergy between content and form, then the form becomes Gestalt. If it's empty, Botox, then it's Botox architecture. And this is a story that we always believe that we are the best, but I think we have to play in a team, otherwise, we are so single heroes, which are really outdated, I think. The situation is normally like this. The architect faces his client. To overcome this client, yeah, with the strengths of this, of our strengths, it's nearly impossible. But what we have to do, like David invented the slingshot in order to fight the guy in the Rüstung, yeah? So another paradigm brings all the people out of the concept. If we don't do it, our office will look like this in 10 years. Empty gas station, no gas, no clients, no nothing, lost in the desert. Yeah, I love him. Yeah, I really love him. He's basically my role model, or was my role model. But I think that's over. This is really over. Ask Patrick. So what we are doing right now, we reorganize our office along the concept of the soccer play of FC Barcelona. There is a theory, but you have to know this. This soccer team is great because the trainer introduces other moves from other ball games into the soccer game, handball, ice hockey, whatever. Yeah. So that means he breaks off the rules of the traditional playing. So, you know, the short pass between three people enforces the development of a strategic plan very, very quickly. But this is a very, let's say, very straightforward system. And Messi is breaking the system, creating unforeseeable situation, very dangerous for the other guys, very dangerous situation, but he is very successful because everyone is calculating with this system. He is breaking the system and creates, like evolution, a new system. So complexity, this is my old saying, complexity is plan is equal section, equals view, equal details, equal architect, equals client, equals everything. So remember, when the grid vanishes, means when the concept and the system vanish, Gestalt still remains. It's like if the grid of the chess plate is vanishing, the power of the draw of the figures still is there in your mind. And this is like architecture creates by the power of the draw, attention field, and the attention field is the point of departure for other ideas. Take your time, very important for students, take your time, but not too long, otherwise it happens to you. So, but seriously, the cross punch strategy is a very important strategy. Could be a city planning strategy because you need a sharp and a fast eye and fast movements. Then maybe you can solve a problem before it becomes a problem. So this is the definition of closed society, which puts up rules and regulation and prohibit by these codes and rules personal development. You know, this is the communication way, maybe in your studio as well as in my studio. Yeah, they send emails to the neighbor which sits 1 meter next to him. Yeah, so losing the language, meaning losing the understandable expression. So the possibility of impossible is very, very, very important. Like Shea said, architecture is heavy, we know, in many ways. I mean, weight. Weight costs time and money, and where time and money is, you will see it later, there are politicians and politics. So we have to invent new strategy, like I mentioned before, to handle this weight earlier than the politician can handle it. When we talk about architecture, and this is very important, for me, it's the most important thing I could teach my students. When we talk about architecture in school or wherever, we are talking about this little piece here. We are talking about aesthetical issue, program issue, quack, quack. But the much more important thing and the resources, why this little peak looks like this, is the so-called invisible part, meaning constraints, politics, money, all these things, the invisible architecture is the driving source of, for this little piece. And you have to handle it. Maybe you know this comparison. 2,500 years ago, architecture looked like this. Now it looks like this. But not only because of the shape. Maybe because of that. The Doric temple needs 36 columns to lift up a roof with 1,400 square meter. BMW, we need only 11 columns to lift up 10 times the size of the roof of the Doric temple. So structure combined with shape could influence the further development of architecture. Or, you know this, the transformation station from here to there. Look, if black would be architecture, and then white is the program. If you would go to a client right now and explain that you need to have architecture like this and the program, I'm sorry. So, shortcut to the way out. So now it looks rather, now architecture looked like this. You can be happy if you get this little black dots here as architecture, and white, of course, is the money-making program. Talking about form, I mentioned it before, the synergy between form and content makes Gestalt. Gestalt as a meta surface, meta level of architecture. It's like the red dot or the blue dot on the wing of an butterfly. Yeah, the evolution is by chance. Nature tries. If it works, okay, it will stay. If it doesn't work, it will disappear. So the other thing is, this is a hawk, a very beautiful bird. Can you see all the details? Can you see how beautiful he is? The prey of the hawk is a goose. A goose only needs to see, the goose doesn't see the beautiful hawk. The goose only see a simplified shape, like a box, a cross. So, can you imagine that this simple shape of a cross can fly like this? Never ever. So, this is one of my favorite sculptures because it's an open system creating a powerful appearance, performance, appearance, presence. This is a closed system. Open systems always force liveliness, closed system prohibited. And therefore, for me, all these elements which are really invented in the fascistic time, if we would use it nowadays, it's very suspicious. It's not reflected authoritarian systems. So shape and form and gestalt, some examples. Very long time ago, it's 87, almost 30 years, yeah, 33 years, a project. This is 2 years later, 4 years later, the cinema center in Dresden, a social housing complex in Vienna as well. Art university, art school in Los Angeles with the library and the fly tower, which is the symbol for the school. This is a project in Italy for an art museum, private art museum. Beautiful site, really beautiful site. We designed it, it's in the far south of Italy. We designed this whole thing because of the cantilever in steel. But the mayor told me, watch out, we are in the mafia area. They're only building concrete. So therefore, we have to recalculate this thing. So anyway, so this is a winning entry in 92 for the Geneva UNO headquarter. We never built it. This is a coming up project in Azerbaijan, in Baku. This is a museum in Bombay, Mumbai, and this is, maybe we can get it in Changsha, office and hotel building. An office building in Vienna, watch out, and a high rise in, I forgot. It's not so important because I don't think we will build it. You know, the client hates the black shimmering surface. Anyway, so maybe. So, and the other way to get shapes in a more funny way is putting music into the form making machine. This is a pavilion for the opera in Munich. It should be a transportable building. It should have a very good acoustic. And this is a discrepancy. Good acoustic you only can get with heavy weight materials. This must be because they want to build it, to construct it up and tear it down and transport it to other places. This must be a lightweight structure. So what we did, we enlarged the surface, created kinds of peaks which are absorbing or reflecting the noise of the outside. You can see that on this acoustical study that by doing so, this wall of the peak wall of the pavilion prohibit to go the noise to go through to the performance space. Therefore, we could get a good acoustic. So this is. I have two songs which I like very much. One is Purple Haze from Jimi Hendrix, and the other one is a part out of Don Giovanni from Mozart. So we used the Purple Haze song in order to create the dimension of the peaks, and the direction is directed by Mozart. Necessary to say that the guy, the director of the opera, was really smashed. So this is one example. The other one is, you know, this the moon Phobos. It's the moon of the Mars, and this moon is circulating the Mars in the wrong direction. All the calculation, the mathematical calculation, said that he should go from right to left, but this guy is not discussing the direction. He does what he wants to do. He's going from. No, actually. So we took this piece, combined it with the Brancusi piece, and then we made it by hand. Shaped it like a dolphin, because I saw a dolphin while diving, and I was really impressed by the appearance of the geometry of his face, so I wanted to build it. So anyway, so this will be... No kidding. Some people ask us to do iconic graphic buildings. And how to do? I think by using a strange geometrical approach makes, like the Gothic churches, makes the building to give the building a very powerful presence. So this is an in-between building. Here you can see that. An in-between building between two museums. One, this is one for modern art, and this is for architecture, urban planning exhibition. It's called, it's in Changsha, Shenzhen in China. And both museums are, of course, under one roof, under one skin. And this is how it looks like. And of course, the dolphin has a program. Not by chance it looks like, yeah, like this, yeah. This is the another bigger dolphin. It was the proposal for the National Museum in Beijing. We lost, of course. The idea was to have a three-dimensional Chinese garden going through all this building, and yeah, of course, we were thrown out, I think, in the first or second round. Anyway, what I really like is the moment of breaking the ground, yeah? Because in this moment, your abstract ideas become reality. So I really like that. And I go to every breaking the ground ceremony I can get for my buildings, of course, yeah? So I show you some building we have under construction. This is the... European, the headquarter of the European Central Bank. And here, I can show you what I mean when I say strange geometrical move gives the building a very special presence. This is the program. The cut, the slice through the program gives us two parts, and the two parts on the inside, first on the inside, an HP surface were put upside down. So the HP surface is outside and the structural pieces are inside. Nevertheless, because this building is on the ground thinner, yeah, smaller than up. So it was is very complex. Very complex structure, reminds me actually, you can see it here, yeah? It reminds me a little bit on the Gothic Cathedral. And to calculate the movement of the building in order to place the facade in the right way was very, very, very difficult. The bankers didn't know. Yeah, but they were delighted about the presence. They were impressed by the presence of this strange high rise. Anyway, so and now we heard that a lot in the last couple of months. Expensive iconic buildings. We don't need them anymore. We need little houses, little boxes. So we calculated the price of the of this building is the price or the budget of 3.5 Eurofighters. The Eurofighter, the three fighter jets, they are outdated in 4 years. In 4 years, they throw it away. Yeah? Not the building. It will be 40 years, maybe. 10 times. Yeah, and when they fire the rockets, one of these guys, these rockets, equals the budget of the maintenance of a year of this building. So we have to place that in the right evaluation. It's not expensive, it's cheap, this building. Only 3.5 fighters, yeah? Germany has 300. So we they should throw it away. We build a lot of, 100 of AZBs. So this is a concert hall in Denmark. It's a music school and a concert hall. To break the wishable shoebox concert hall, wishable for the client, we introduced the movement of waves, because this is on a fjord in Denmark, and we came to this shape. And even the light looks like underwater. So it's under construction. The other thing we had under construction is this project. We won this competition in 2001, the same time we won BMW and all the other things we already finished 5 years ago. Beautiful site, political reasons. Now we have it under construction, beautiful site. The concept was to lift up the museum in order to let people through from the city to the so-called nature, to the river. Yeah, this is the fabric of the city. And all the other projects were placed in the middle of the island, peninsula, placed boxes which prohibited people going from the city to the river. So this is the concept, actually, walk-through system. The dynamic forces, it was also done in 2001, the dynamic forces of the together coming of two rivers we used for a dynamic structural system, and it's very, very beautiful to see how this idea becomes reality. Yeah, and it's very beautiful to see this very tough to design structural pieces when they are one-to-one on site, ready to be built in. Before I explain the Busan Cinema Center, I would like to do an excursus about roof. The roof is meant to be a protective element in architecture. But since Niemeyer designed a roof which doesn't follow the ground plan, and Corbusier designed a roof which is a landscape, the roof becomes an element of meaning, so to say. So, and we did a lot of exercises how we can deal with the roof. Yeah, this is the house with the flying roof in London. Yeah, this is an object which is kind of explaining a project of a flat cupola. This is a project in Mexico where the roof was distorted by gravity, differentiating the space underneath. This is the BMW roof, where the roof has a program already, and Lyon is nothing else but a programmed roof. So you can read the BMW project like this, the upside down landscape of Corbusier's rooftop, and dynamic forces for structure, how we designed the roof from top to the bottom. And it turns out that the sculptured form of the underside of the roof differentiates the space in a very complex way. People don't see it, but they can feel that there is a differentiation. So hand drawing is not that easy, as you can see. So this is, it's done in 2001, I think. This is the roof, yeah, coming from this dynamic force of the double cone, creating kind of differentiated space. And we programmed the space as a public space. It's not a shopping mall for cars. It's really a public space because there are cars, of course, but restaurants, cinema, theater stage, spaces for fashion shows and so forth. And they have more, they have 2.8 million visitors a year, not only because of the cars. This is how it looks like. Good. Yeah, this is, yeah. Nothing to say, the people speak by themselves. So, another kind of roof, and the further development of the BMW is, of course, the Busan project is it's the project for the a building for the Asian movie festival. We designed a kind of urban landscape with a little hill and a mountain, the little hill housed the media center, the media school, and we call it the Cinema Mountain, has a multifunctional theater and three cinemas. And in between, so to say, in the valley, there is an open air cinema for 4,000 to 6,000 visitors, covered by a roof. One roof. And for the red zone, for the red carpet zone, we designed a very special roof. The double cone from where the roof is coming out is the lobby for the stars. So anyway, this is how it looks like, day and night. It was very important to design it for day and night. And the roof cantilevers 85 meters. I think it's a world record. I don't know who wrote that, but I'm proud of that. Yeah. Anyway, so when we had it under construction, and the roof was lying down, it was ready to go up, we got to know that the wind codes changed because the wind is getting stronger and stronger in the Asian countries. So from 200, it was calculated for 200 miles an hour, and they wanted to have the roof calculated for 280 miles. So what to do? Dismount it, calculate it new, throw it away? No. We introduced a little hydraulic column here, two little hydraulic columns. If the wind goes stronger than 200 miles per hour, the columns come up and keep the roof from flying away. Saved us half a year, and it was not costly. So there's some images. Day and night. This is in between. This is day. You can see the seat for the 4,000 people. This is the so-called cinema mountain, the entrance. And this, the roof looks like that when it becomes dark. It's a public space. It's not only for cinemas. I saw a beautiful video exhibition. They played it on the roof. I saw a beautiful sculpture exhibition there. So people are using it as a public space. Here you can see people sitting and looking at the cinema. It's kind of, you know, you have to go there, actually, in order to understand. No, the flow of the space is, and that dynamic flow of the space you only can experience when you are walking through. To be honest, pictures are lying. A little bit like pornography, yeah? Telephone sex. Not real. So this is the opening. I got the honorable opening. Now you are citizen. And now you have to pay taxes here. So and you know, a little bit like a cloud, huh? So we are going to China very fast, very quick. I would love to go that quick to China, to be honest. Before I came to London, I went into the plane which brought me to London, I got a call that the mayor of Dalian wants to give me an honorable citizenship for Dalian on Friday. So I have to go there. A beautiful site. We could enlarge the site. This is the landscape design, and this is the concept, which I would call the power of the inside pushes the skin of the outside. In the middle, there is a big opera building in the first floor, so to say, and these are conference rooms for about 6,000 people. So it's a little city, yeah? And the conference room are pushing the skin of the outside, because we need place in order to house public space between the opera and the conference spaces. It's similar, actually, like this BMW design of Chris Bangle, where he designed a car which is pushing the skin a little bit. This is the program model. You can see the public space is getting big. The lobby is very, very large. It's like six soccer team fields. Studies. Yeah. So this is what we have to do as architects. So and this is, you can see that there is a ramp going through the, this enormous large space and connects the conference spaces with the opera. The opera building was very sophisticated because they wanted to have a multifunctional opera, meaning that they wanted to have the normal acoustic acoustical quality and the electroacoustic quality. So what we did, we combined both conditions in one design. You will see it later. The structure is like, yeah, like building a ship. I liked it, that what Corbusier said, that he wants to build houses like ships. We did it. I'll show you later. So this is the geometry of the facade, and you know, and this is the reality. The energy concept, no black box, saving energy by letting natural light into the space. And all these other craftsmen like climate design issues. I think it's not worth to discuss it, it's craftsmanship. This is what we have to do. But by using this energy system very correctly, we could give the facade a very lively approach. Model, yeah, reality. Rendering, and then it becomes reality. And this is what I meant when what Corbusier meant. Yeah. Building things in the shipyard is one of my favorite idea. Yeah. This is a construction not for Dalian, done in the shipyard. This is a part of a museum in Groningen, in Holland. We did in a shipyard. This is how it looks like when it was finished. And this is a roof for a little project I did in my hometown. Yeah, to show you how big this project is, this is a human being. This is where people meet in architecture. So anyway, so I love the structural, the construction images because, yeah, you know, this is like, next time I would like to leave it like that, yeah? Mm-hmm. It's like Piranesi. It's really Piranesi. And this is how it looks, almost finished. The liveliness of the facade and the pushing out concrete spaces you can read here, definitely. Hello. Yeah, I love it. I really love it. And this is very well done, astonishingly. We had good local architects and three people of my office were there and really pushed them to do what we wanted to do. So look at this, it's a little city. If we have daylight, the daylight tubes are golden inside, colored. Therefore, the metal of the inside becomes sometimes a very silk fabric impression. Yeah. This is the same like Busan. You have to go there in order to experience it. This is the theater half finished, almost finished. Yeah, very Chinese sometimes. Yeah, this is. You can read the inside and the outside, and sometimes it's the conference spaces are pushing really the skin and deform the regularity of the outside. So this is a big one, and this is the small one, the last project. It could be the ticket office of this building, but it is a little church in my hometown. The church was very small. It's 64, there, where people are praying. It's a Protestantic church. It's 64, 8 by 8 by 8 meters. Very small. And of course, there are some maintenance rooms around it, but the main thing is the church where people are praying. This is, I'll show you later, this is the model. This is like it looked before, and this is now. You know, the trick is you have to photograph it when it's raining, and then. So architecture brings sun in to your life. So anyway, so yeah. Guess who is the role model for this church? Of course. We are on the A. Do you have history in architecture? Okay, this is Rochon from Corbusier. And this is my favorite, is La Tourette. And both together, you can see here. This is a very old, it's a medieval bone house from the Gothic times. What we did is, we took the geometry of the roof and transported it, so to say, into contemporary times. Then we scripted it, you know this game, and then we built a model and destroyed the scripted shape by hand, so to say, in order to get this shape. And the difference between La Tourette, yeah, where there were kind of light tubes as well, is that we sculptured the inside of the ceiling as well. Done in a shipyard 1,000 miles away from Hamburg. This is my hometown. In three parts, transported to the site, welded together. Same thing. Yeah, some details. Very old, very contemporary. Inside, you know, it's very tough to get sharp edges with these shapes. So we ordered a very old guy who could make plaster on the base of a shaped reed. And this is very strange, yeah? It's very strange. It's a very old geometry transformed into contemporary thing, built in a very old method. It's very churchish, I would say. This is how it looks like. And the other thing is, look at this, the joint between the wall and the roof. It's like, this is the very stupid way to do it. Mies van der Rohe puts the roof on the wall. Corbusier invents the joint of light, flying roof. And here you can see a little Corbusier and a little further developed Mies. This is the structure of the facade, it's like it's coming from the desert. There's a lot of stories how lucky the priests were when they heard it. It's from sand, it's from the desert. The three light tubes, they thought I'm very religious. This is a kind of unconscious randomness, or a conscious randomness, I would say. And this is the sketch of the altar. Geometrical, the same geometry like the roof, transported into a sculpture. So, and this is the altar. And this is how it looks like. You know, it's a Protestantic church. It's not mystic. They want to have a glass front and things open. Openness was the issue. And this is how it looks like at the very end. So, just a glimpse in my future, because I'm winded up by some topics I would like to show. The best description of architecture I ever read, I read in Melville's book Moby Dick. Namely, he wants to have the wind with a body. Can you imagine? The wind has a body. It's like architecture, space. And this is what I propose every student. Anything goes, but you have to be optimistic looking in the future, not being pessimistic, not being afraid, but knowing that you can solve the problems like Cassius Clay. Before there are real problems, you have to counterpunch. And then maybe you get this nice blue and white poster. Anything goes. So I think, not the future of architecture, but I think that architecture should have no gravity, no columns. I hate columns. And buildings hanging in the sky would be a good goal. Yeah, columns taking pressure. Tension rods are dynamic. Yeah. Anyway, so no gravity. Yeah. Then the single focused perspective is out. It's obsolete, because we know how to go in gravity-less space. So, and not by chance, I have to say, not by chance. You have to take the same position in Corbusier's chair like the astronauts when they overcome the gravity. Not by chance. Yeah, and structures generated by music. Imagine the reverse thing, yeah? This is the structure of the BMW. We can translate that in music, but the other way around would be great, having music and create structures out of it. And materials like sound, yeah. Always, when I hear the introduction of Gimme Shelter, of Keith Richard, he is playing one tone, which provokes in my brain the imagination of a material which is like strong like concrete, but transparent and soft like a speak. Listen. He's playing that on the A string, yeah? A very, you can hear that, yeah, once again. I really want to build a building with this material, sooner or later. So, and the functions of our brains as a role model for the future, this is what we are working on. Actually, we are working on all these topics right now in our office. So, at the very end, I play you dedicated to the my most famous and my really beloved strophe of Dylan's Desolation Row, and it goes like that, and it has a meaning.
Yes, I received your letter yesterday about the time the doorknob broke. When you asked me how I was doing, was that some kind of joke? All these people that you mentioned, yes, I know them, they're quite lame. I had to rearrange their faces and give them all another name. Send me no more letters, no, not unless you mail them from Desolation Row.
So thank you very much.
Thank you, Wolf. Questions? Can we do a couple questions?
Yeah.
We have time.
Yeah. When did you make the reservation?
Oh, we have plenty of time. questions in the audience, anybody?
Thank you. Appreciate that. No question, I appreciate it.
We'll give them a minute or two. Wolf, just maybe say something very briefly about, you mentioned it twice in the lecture, that the topic of research into the, let's call it the contemporary city.
Yeah.
And because you were largely showing in this remarkable catalog of individual building projects, I'm just wondering the way in which that topic of, let's say, planning urban space and design might be working either in the studio or maybe in some of the teaching work that you continue to do. I know it played an important role in, to me, about 25 years ago when you guys moved from rooftop house and those kind of projects to large scale, particularly in Europe, urban planning projects. The studio goes through an interesting, Melun Sinar and other projects at the time.
What's the question?
Are you working on that scale of problem or project right now within the office or in some of the academic work?
Of course. No, not academic, but in the office. We are doing research work comparing, together actually with the with Walt Singer, who is a brain researcher, the very famous one, yeah. And I heard a lecture of him long time ago where he said that our brain is changeable, yeah. It changed from, I mentioned it before, it changed according to the province we have to solve. So the synapses are not organized hierarchic and not organized basic democratic, so to say, that everyone is connected to everyone, but they changed the mode according to the problem. And I mentioned it before, if we are able to, we tried to figure out how we can translate that in architecture, and it turns out it's politic. So this is the meta-ebene of city planning. We can design fabulous projects, fabulous, very nice one, but we cannot get through with it because we need the politics, the unseeable, the architecture, so to say. We need the politics and new strategies to not only to convince the politician, but also the inhabitants. Because you know, the Wutbürger in Germany is a very common topic. Yeah, Wutbürger means the angry citizen, yeah, who is against everything. Yeah, a new train station, no, because there's one tree which is more worth than, yeah, so and so forth. We have to take them and convince them, yeah? But the problem is, yeah, there is a problem. The problem is that complex problems need complex solution. Complex solution have the advantage, have the disadvantage that they are very hard to understand. So therefore, the politicians have a lot of problems. They cannot explain the complexity of the daily life we are facing. Yeah. The simple solutions, the authoritarian solution, they are understandable and people are going for that because they are understandable. So, but the advantage of the complex solution is that every complex solution is new. The simple solution is never new. So this is the problem we have to face in city planning. So maybe we solve it. I have time the next 10 years. I promise I will get some solution.
I'm wondering if that, just as a response, if that might segue into a slightly different kind of question, because I've always been struck by the role of performance and action early as you guys begin your work. And I'm just wondering at this point in your career, if you could look back for a moment, because one thing you could say that performance pieces do is they do attempt to reveal a kind of complexity of life at that moment, which was happening across Europe and in many other cities. Is there either a role or a reflection on your interest in performance and action? And it was arguably a generational project that you were a part of then. But if there is something still to the possibility of performance today, and either how you understand this kind of work or in doing things that we don't see on the screen with these kind of projects that might still be out there for you to.
If I would be able to dance like Christopher Warden, I would do it. Yeah, no problem. Yeah. But I can't dance like he's doing. The performance, forever young, it doesn't exist. Yeah, I can't do that. This is something for the young people. They have to invent how to present and how to get through. It's not my duty anymore, I have to say. Our duty, and I mean the generation I'm in, we have to push the border line, yeah? This is what we can do, in reality. So that you can jump in, move in on this field. If you don't do it, it's not my problem, it's your problem. Yeah? This is what, if we can build what he is doing, or Saha is doing, yeah? If we can do it, so this is an example how architecture could be, and maybe if the city plan will be finished, I'll show it to you. I promise that I will come and give a lecture about the brain city, so to say, that shows some example. Yeah? what I like in your language is pushing the envelope. This is great. We don't have that in German. Wir können den Umschlag nicht pushen. Yeah? And this is great. And this is what we have to do, and what the generation before us, the good ones, yeah, not the stupid ones, not the, you know, we have, there are some talent-free architects around.
Question here, Charles?
Don't ask me about talent, who?
Yeah. No names.
Talent-free architects.
It's tough. Wolf, you know, in the 60s, they thought that neurons don't grow in the brain. That was the paradigm, right? And then they found out in the 80s that birds had every spring to get a mate. The male birds learned new songs. And then they did the operations on the brains, and they found actually neurons are grown in the brain, and it was a big lift up for us. And I'm thinking that new theory of neurogenesis, well, since the 80s, now it's accepted as science, sort of backs up backs up the plasticity. Yeah. No question, you're right, and your neurologist is right. That's where it is. But it was 20 years ago, it was against the standard dogma.
Yeah.
And so it's nice that music is common to both sex and brain sex and the growth of the brain and birds. Anyway, just a comment on, I don't have a question so much because your thing is multimedia performance. It doesn't ask a question, it asks an answer. So I'm wondering though, if you would comment on scaling. I asked Zaha the other day here on the same thing because there's something I like your projects when I feel that, and I feel the architectural idea is really coming through, as in Corb. You know my love for Corb, so we have the same love there. And when I see some of the scale of your projects, like the one I think that you were answering, the EU Bank, because you're feeling the pressure from the little houses and little wood houses and all those people who are angry today with iconic architects like you and Zaha and Frank. Everybody's on the run, at least, you know, they're all feeling the pressure. And the bank, however, is a big building, and for bankers. So the content of the, let me just finish. Anyway, so you feel the pressure of that, because bankers are not loved today.
Don't be so simple.
No, I'm not, but I'm just, let me, so, I'm asking you about scaling. I'm asking,
okay.
I'm defending. First of all, I think the iconic building is here forever and is never going to go away in a global marketplace and for all sorts of reasons, including the end of organized religion, which is another funny comment on the end of your lecture. But anyway. I mean, I'm asking you to wrestle with the things that you may not like as much in your own work because of the scale. Because when you blow up an idea, let's take your wonderful Dalian building, which was very strong and convincing, but I looked at it and I thought of all the other ginormous buildings around it, lacking scale. And I really. Look what, if those big, scaling is very important in complexity and fractals. Okay, it is. And your music pavilion had a wonderful way. I mean, that little tiny music pavilion really had a fractal dimension, and it had a scaling for me. So I just want you to maybe say some of your buildings you like better than others. And maybe you comment on that. Oh, yeah, by scaling. Because I don't think you had the ability to scale much. I may be wrong, because I haven't been to the Vienna high-rise. The bank, the EU bank, is so...
Frankfurt.
It's EU, no?
Yeah.
Oh, it's in Frankfurt.
EU is Frankfurt.
Okay. Yeah, but all right, I'm just asking you if you would comment on your own work and slightly tell us, say more, because, you know, I feel there's an edginess in your own view of yourself.
If you are working in China, you have to respect that everything is much bigger, taller, whatever, than you would expect. This is because they have a lot of people running around there. So the scale, yeah, you know, the buildings around that are 400 meter high hotels. Yeah, this is crazy. So I was a little bit insulted that they were so high, making our buildings so small. But if you go there, and I'm very proud of it, to be honest, that inside and outside, it's not a corporate building. Yeah, it would look different if I would have done it corporate, means scratch, scratch, boom, boom, simple things. Yeah, because of the variety of details, especially in the facade, it gets a scale when you are there.
Like, yeah. Dalian, yeah.
Yeah. And the high rise in Frankfurt, the place where it's done, this high rise, not because of the EU, but because of people working there and it's a public space as well, is the point of departure of a new city center. Yeah? And this is what I'm going for, and I'm responsible for this idea that I hate monocentric cities. Medieval-wise, it's okay, but now we need, in order to create a tension field, we need multi-layered city, multi-center, multi-centric city, yeah? In order to create this tension field where new things could provoke. So this is a short answer to a long question. No, thank you very much. It's always good. Yeah, and you have to know that we have to fight our colleagues in Germany, because there is an old building. We have to integrate the old building. And we made a cut through the building because we need an entrance for the new building. And this was a big discussion for the stony Berlin guys, yeah? You know, these are the guys who are doing boxes and they cannot fly. Anyway, so what we proved that all this dimension are developed from the proportion which are not bad from this old building. So I didn't show it because it was there. So this is like maybe you know the gasometer, where were these tanks in Vienna, where we did a kind of banded addition. This is the geometry of the inside of the building we took outside, so therefore the Landmark Protection Society could follow us, yeah? Because the geometry is contemporary, of course, and the expression is contemporary, but the point of departure is almost the same. Yeah, so thank you very much. I appreciate your patience.
Questions? Over here? Anybody?
No?
Over here? Anyone?
Thank
just one
you.
Back here.
The question is, actually, I really appreciate the humorous of your project. It's really nice, especially in your theoretical architectural world. But I'm thinking, how can you calculate the payment of the idea you're going to pay for that? I mean, for example, the bank tower, I think you just use a slide and cut it and replace the two pieces. You have to pay a lot for that, no matter structurally or I mean, economically, you can calculate that. And also, how can you convince your clients like doing something like that?
I'm used to this question. I have to explain you in detail the way Barcelona is playing. It's very economic. First, this is the economic question. We are very quick. We are fast. Because in Austrian, the term is der geschwindere ist der gesündere. That means the faster one is the more healthier one. And the second one, more serious answer is, I had a discussion with my friend Mirai a long time ago. And we, and Levius Woods as well, we were on common ground when we said designing is thinking. And you cannot measure thinking by money. It depends on you whether you want to do something which is filling you up. Or if you don't, if you do things which are foreign to you and you push it away, I tell you what, then you need many girlfriends, a yacht, a Porsche, an airplane, or things like that in order to satisfy what, yeah, your work. You understand? No? Okay, I invite you to come to our office, work with us, then you will see. I'm not, we are not starving. We are very quick thinker. So, at the very end, I tell you a story about my flight from LA to London. It was the first time that I, it was a long time ago, that I could upgrade. I came to the first class and I say, a very famous architect, it was not Frank Gehry, I have to say. Yeah, a very famous architect sitting next to me. He turned around and said, how come that, how can you afford first class? I said, excuse me, blah, blah, blah. And we started to talk. 6 hours we had, the bar was empty. I heard everything about his private life. How many girlfriends, how many shrinks, how many buildings. I just signed my 99th contract. Details, how he invented details. And after 9 hours, I think, the, you know, the sign comes up, fasten seatbelt, we are going to land. And he said, oh no, we were a little bit drunk. I said, oh, I'm so sorry. I talked all the time, I talked about me. So let's talk about you. How do you like my latest design, which I will prepare? So this is the, therefore I think, I don't know any other profession where the people diminish their own profession by being stupid so much than the profession of being an architect. The architects nowadays, they not only saw on the branch they are sitting on, they use motor saw. Good luck for the future, I wish you.